Good morning, everybody. This is going to be quite a difficult, unpleasant video to make. So if you do not feel like listening to some dark and negative, heavy stuff with a religious undertone, then now is the time for you to click out. I have been putting off doing this video because of the amount of shame that I feel around it, and also because I feel a huge amount of guilt that I actually placed myself in the position for what happened to have happened to me. And if I wasn't in that situation or in that position, that what happened would not have happened to me. I think there's a handful of people that I actually told this to, and I can't believe that I'm actually going to make this video and put it on social media regarding this issue. Yes. I was raped by my first boyfriend that I had at a very early age. In secondary school, high school, it was not supposed to be a sexual relationship. It was supposed to be an innocent relationship of doing stuff together and not become what it became. And I think that I need to address men's perception and how they react to the word no. And I think it's important to know that the word no has got no other meaning but no. The word no doesn't mean maybe or yes. Or it's okay if you do what you want to do, even if I don't want you to do that. The word no means exactly what it means when you hear it, and that means no. I'm 57 years old, and I actually even experience this now at the age of 57. Men has got a hard time to accept no. I don't have to give you an explanation if I say no. I don't want you to try and change my mind if I say no. I don't want you to keep on pushing the boundaries when I say no. Because I've got my reasons why my no is no, or why I don't want to do it, or why I say no. I think most people that know me, and maybe that's on this channel that has been watching some of my videos, should know by now that 7 years, it's about 7 years ago, I have made the decision that I am not interested in sexual relationships with men anymore. I can't say, maybe decision is the wrong word. Maybe the life changes has caused the fact that I am not really interested in sexual relationships anymore. Because my menopause didn't go the other way, where I just went through menopause and it was like nothing has ever happened, or that my sexual desires have stayed the same or has increased. The things that happened to my body has made me lose complete and total interest in sex. Let me just call it what it is. And I have addressed this issue in that video that I made on the huge age gap relationships. I actually did spend a few minutes at the end of that video addressing this embarrassing situation. But it is part of life. It's going to happen to all young girls, young women. And like I said, it's part of life. I've got a lot of men that would like to have a relationship with me, other than a friendship relationship, a deeper relationship with me, that now, currently, than what I am willing or prepared to offer them. And and then there's also men that's in relationships themselves and that's married, that also keep on pushing their boundaries all the time. Now, on the issue with relationships with married men, I have the following to say. And I am going to make a video on one of my neighbors because he turned very sour about the whole situation because his efforts did not pay off. And now he's doing the most craziest things to try and get back at me for making a fool of him. But I didn't make a fool of him. I just ignored his advances over my phone. I just didn't react to it. So I just feel that that was his own doing. If you have a relationship with a married man, this is my opinion. First of all, now, I don't, people say, well, why don't you tell their wives? I don't want to tell their wives because I don't want them to get into a fight and I don't want them to be thrown out of their house or the marriage or the relationship to end, because then they are going to come knocking on my door, because then they are going to be free and they're not going to be in a married relationship anymore. So I don't want them. I think that their wives must have them. And that's why I don't go and make ruptions there. I try to handle it as nicely as I can, not to be completely and totally rude to the people, but most of the time I will ignore them and I will not give them the opportunity to come and visit me. So when you are in a relationship, you entertain married people, you really only do yourself a huge injustice, because they have their bread buttered on all sides. They have their wives, which 99% of the time they have 100% excuses why they cannot leave their wives or their current marital situation to be with you, number one. So they still do everything with their marriage partner of choice. They do Christmas together, they go away on wonderful, fantastic holidays, they celebrate Valentine's Day together, they celebrate Mother's Day and Father's Day, all the children's birthdays, the wife's birthday, his birthday. So none of that actually stops. But where are you? You can't spend Christmas with that guy because he's with his family. You can't go on a holiday away with him unless he lies and it's a business, a business trip, maybe. Every now and again, if they don't have a lot of money, if they have a lot of money, I think they can do that much more often. But you still get the crumbs. Your birthday cannot really be celebrated. You will sit at home on your birthday. You will not be the one that you love. You can't really get any presents and being spoiled and treated to be taken to a shop to go buy some clothes. You can't be seen in public with a guy unless you're on a sneaky holiday someplace. You actually do yourself a huge injustice, apart from the wrong that there is to have a relationship with a married guy. You make yourself very, very lonely and very, very miserable at the same time because you now must sit all by yourself at home, knowing that he is actually every night, every day, that he can't be with you. He is like having fun and spending time with somebody else, his wife and his family. So that's just now my take on having relationships with married men and why I don't entertain married men. And I do have them knocking on my door being single. And a situation where no is not really accepted as no. Then I don't think that there is any wrong having a relationship with somebody of the opposite sex when you are in a relationship with somebody. And maybe that is because I know I can do it successfully, that I can really have a friendship relationship with somebody of the opposite sex without stepping out of the boundaries or over the boundaries and taking it to another level, which it should be. So I know that I can have an absolute 100% friendship relationship with somebody of the opposite sex. I do find it a little bit ridiculous that if we are living in a world of only two sexes, males and females, that when you enter into a relationship or into a marriage relationship, that all of a sudden now you are not allowed to have any friends of the opposite sex. All your friends that you had, you must now do away with. You can't have them anymore. And you are now only supposed to be with your wife. She's the only female person that you are actually now allowed to have contact with and male friends. I do think if you must limit somebody to that extent to make sure that that person stays faithful to you, that the foundation that your marriage, your relationship, and your love is based upon is then not a very strong foundation. I would hate to think that I must be shackled to the kitchen table leg in a relationship, because if I live life in the way that the population is made up of, that any interactions with somebody of the opposite sex would then end up in a huge confrontation, a huge fight, accusations being flung at you that you can't be trusted or that you have a relationship with somebody or that's not the way, in my opinion, to live life. One of the reasons why I have decided that being single and having no accountability or responsibility towards another person is the best for my sanity. Because to have to constantly defend yourself against the ghosts and the fears in somebody else's mind, which doesn't exist, is not a pleasant experience because you cannot defend yourself against something that's not real. How do you defend yourself against an accusation which you know for 100% is a false accusation? You know within yourself that nothing that you're accused of is based on remotely any truth. You can't. It's a losing battle. It's just a unpleasant situation, all in all. So back to what happened to me when I was very young with my first boyfriend. I was allowed to go to church with him on Sunday evenings. And we were at his house, and we were kissing, and he asked me if we could do that, and I said no, I don't want to have sex. I was very young, and I didn't want to engage in sexual relationships before I was married, and I just didn't want to do it. I wasn't ready. It wasn't something that was discussed in our house, and I didn't really know anything about it, and I was scared, and it was just not something that I wanted to do. And he sort of pushed the fact a little bit, and I didn't want to do it. So what happened next, and I'm not going to go in much detail, I'm just going to say what happened, was that he rammed himself into me. Needless to say that it wasn't a very pleasant experience. So it was only one hard, brutal shove, which then broke my hymen. And there was a lot, and if I say a lot, then I mean there was a lot of blood. And I was hysterical. I was hysterical. I was crying. I was upset. I yelled at him that I trusted him. He said he wouldn't do it when he asked me, and I said no. I trusted him, and he violated my trust. Something that once it's done, you can never undo it. You can never get that back. And all my clothes was full of blood. Now I had to try and get that out. I could not get everything out and make everything invisible. And I had to now go into my house, knowing what it's like, hoping nobody is going to see me. And if maybe I had a different relationship with my parents, I could have gone to them and I could have told them what happened, which obviously wasn't the case. So I walked around with that guilt and shame of what happened to me, and thinking that everybody could see what has happened to me. Everybody now knows what has happened to me, and that me thinking that I'm hiding it is not successful. And I actually went on and had, he was my boyfriend. I still went out with him then after that event. For 2 years, and he was in grade 12, and we have a matric farewell, which is like overseas proms, and I wasn't allowed to go with him to the matric farewell. My mom didn't allow me to go with with him, and he had to then ask somebody else to go with him to the matric farewell, which he then ended up cheating me with. And he then had a brief relationship with her. And then some other event took place, which I will do another video on. Later in my university years, I sometimes caught a lift with him to university and back home. And he eventually ended up marrying somebody else. He did ask me to marry him twice. He asked me at university before he got involved with his first wife. He asked me if I would marry him, which I declined because I didn't feel any love for him anymore. After the cheating experience in grade 12, I basically had to work. I was extremely hurt. I was extremely, extremely hurt, and I felt extremely, extremely betrayed. And I had to work very, very hard to get over the disappointment of a broken relationship. My heart was broken. And so when he asked me, I didn't have those feelings in me anymore. I had to mentally worked on forcing those feelings to die and not be there anymore. And then there's very little chance for you to conjure it back up once you have mentally suppressed those feelings and once you then eventually got over a relationship. So I did not feel and see my way through to say yes to his proposal. And he then went on and he married his first wife, and he had a daughter. And at that point in time, he was still traveling with his work, and he was in Port Elizabeth. And he asked if he could see me. And I did see him in his hotel room. His little girl was then born. And he apologized to me for what he did. I don't know if the fact that he had a little girl then made him think about that. But the reason why he wanted to see me was to apologize to me for what he did, because his words to me was he think that my life would have turned out a lot different if he didn't do what he did when he did it. And I accepted his apology, not that it changed anything. And then something went wrong between him and his first wife, and they got divorced. And then he came to see me, and he asked me if I don't think that we can try, that he actually proposed to me again, and he wanted us to give it a try. To be quite honest with you, my house became my safe haven. So I don't think that I will ever be able to give my house up for anybody or anything, unless it becomes unpleasant for me to stay here. I did answer my cousin, and she left a comment on one of my videos, and I did answer her and said that I think if they start to build the low-cost housing in this open patch across the road from where I stay, that will be the day that I will sell my house and go someplace else, because I think the atmosphere and everything of what I've gotten used to and why I love staying here will then have changed. And then the wild birds will move away in any case, because it will then be a built-up area. But I have come to a stage where I don't really worry much about tomorrow because of my situation that I find myself in health-wise. And I don't know if I'm going to be here tomorrow. So I basically have a mentality of living for today. And a lot of people say, you know, yesterday, you can't do anything about yesterday. Yesterday is in the past, and you can't really, you don't have any control over tomorrow. You don't know if tomorrow is actually ever going to come. So all what you basically have control over is now. All my animals always wants to be with me. I'm sitting in my shop. I think I said earlier on that I'm actually sitting in my shop room, because the power is off and I've got one plug working and the plug is here. So all my packing material is standing around here. Oh, no, Benji. And now the animals want to be here with me, as Bella's one leg has been giving her noticeable problems. And I have I've now given her medicine. She can't step on it at all. That's why I get so petrified if she and, you know, Binky man. That's why I get so petrified if Prada play so roughly with Bella, and I basically always shout at them if they play, because I'm so scared she might hurt herself, and I don't have the money to fix her this time. If she hurts something badly, I will have to then put her down, and that's not a decision I want to make at this point in time. But she's not stepping on her leg at all. And it's just hanging very limp, which I find worrying. It's not like she's if you touch it, she's not giving any resistance. It's just limp. I don't find myself in a very good position at this point in time, and this YouTube thing is going very, very, very slow. People are reluctant to subscribe, and people don't really watch a person's content so that you can build up those 4,000 watch hours very quickly, so that you can actually get to a point where you can help yourself financially through YouTube. So it is a very difficult process, but I am digressing again. And so I don't think at that point when he asked me, when he was here to ask me if I would consider to marrying them, and if I don't think that we should try, I don't think that I will ever be able to give up my house, because I have found my sanity, my safety here in this house. Why am I friends with a lot of my exes? And when terrible things have happened, or things didn't go too well in the relationships, and the breakups weren't the most friendliest of breakups they could have been, I don't know. But I am friends with most of my exes, not all, but a lot. And I just feel if there was something that you found endearing in a person, and that you did love at some point in time, and you did spend a part of your life with that person, then there must be something to them that just because you couldn't be in a close relationship with one another or get to a stage where you completely accept and understand one another and things went wrong, that person has now become somebody that you don't like. I don't know, am I explaining myself really well? Yeah, I don't think so. But I am friends with some of them, and obviously there are times that they then get into relationships with somebody else because they don't stay in the same city that I stay in, and life goes on and they meet people that they would like to get into a relationship with and get involved with and get engaged with and get married with. And then during that period of time, I will lose contact with them. So there are sort of interruptions in the relationships when they are in relationships with other people. And I then don't hear from them. And then when those relationships don't work out, then I hear from them again. And then the friendship just picks up as if there never was any break in the friendship. And it carries on until the next relationship, and then there's a break in the relationship where I don't hear from them until something goes wrong there and they're not in that relationship anymore, and then I will hear from them again because my address and my phone number always stays the same. I'm always here. Yeah, so you'll often hear me talk about Roland, and you will hear me talk about Marius, and yeah, all people out of my past, which I value their friendship now, because it is now actually truly a friendship, a friendship with somebody that actually really knows me very, very well, knows all my bad habits, the awful things in my personality, and accepts me with those not so nice things about me as a person, and that's still there as a friend. So it's at the point where it is really just pure interaction between two personalities or two souls, if that makes any sense. And that is where I actually am in my life at this point in time. The fact that I've made the decisions that I have made, apart from the fact that I went through the change of life and menopause, and that took away a lot of my sexual desires, which I am not going to force it to come back. It's not like I can drink a Viagra. But you can equate it to the same. When the men have these discussions with me, or not really arguments, but the persuasive conversations of why I don't just give them a chance. Because if they do this and that to me, then, you know, it will change. No, it won't change. You're not going to be that one person with the magic hands that's going to make a change. It is a biological thing, that change in a woman's body. I think about it differently. My mind is not there anymore. So it's not going to change. You're not going to be the magic man with the magic touch that's going to make what happens with a woman after she's been through menopause, not all those things is now not going to be there anymore. It doesn't, unfortunately, in life, it doesn't work like that. It's like, for instance, if there was no Viagra for you to take and you can't have an erection, and now I think that my magic touch is going to fix the fact that you've got erectile problems. It doesn't work that way. It just doesn't work that way. And I also, when you have such a near-death experience that you literally were seconds away from dying. You come back with a complete and total different outlook on life. And I am a Christian. I am a Christian, and I have tried many times not to believe in God. I have tried because I've messed up so many times in my life. And during those times, I became angry towards God. There were times that I got upset that why isn't he listening to my prayers? Why doesn't he just wave the magic wand and take all my problems away? There were many times that I was upset with him, angry with him, that I fought with him, that I didn't want to believe in him anymore. I don't know how to not believe in God. I don't know how not to believe in God. I just know that he exists and that he is a reality. I know that. Because when I go through the times of being so scared and fearful of death and feeling so terrible on the medications that I have been on and not knowing what's going on with me now. Am I now having another heart attack? Am I going to die now within the next hour or two? Why am I feeling so terrible when all those fears get hold of me? Then I pray. I find myself praying. I will reach out to God and I will pray. And there is always a peace that come over me. Just a peace. He's not magically healing me at that point in time. I don't magically don't have COVID now all of a sudden. But there is definitely a calmness and a peace that comes over me. And so all I know, I always say to people that I look differently at prayer. You know, we so often think that we pray and if we believe enough, then our prayers will be answered. It must be answered because the Bible tells us so. And then to make us feel better because our prayers often is not immediately answered and we often is not sort of rescued out of our dire strait situations immediately, we then will say, you know, God has his own time for answering prayers and he's got his own reasons why he will put us through trials and tribulations. Let me just say this. So often people will lose their faith in God and will stop believing in God because it was a time when they really prayed and that prayer wasn't answered. And then they say, well, then God doesn't exist because we are made to believe that if we pray and we really believe that our prayers will always be answered. I don't have the answers around prayer and the answering of prayers and why prayers aren't answered and why we have this mindset and belief that all prayers should be answered. Because the Bible tells us so, but there's a lot of things that I don't understand around the Bible. But I do know that if you don't die suddenly in a plane crash, or of a sudden heart attack and you die of old age or you have a sick bed, that there's always one prayer that won't be answered, and that is the prayer, if it's your time to leave this life, planet Earth, to be healed or not to die. There's going to be one prayer that won't be answered if it's your time to go, because then it's your time to go. But through everything, I just know that I don't know how not to believe in God. And I pray. I pray a lot, but I don't pray with a mindset that what I asked for must be answered, or my problems must disappear magically, or my financial woes must now all of a sudden not be there anymore. Because if I really think about it, I'm trying to help myself with YouTube at this point in time, because how else must God relieve me from my financial burden? The money is not going to come magically raining out of the sky. Well, I'm not going to wake up and go to one of the trees in my garden and be able to pick money off the tree like I'm picking apples. That's not going to happen. Which is one of the big reasons that I've started to work on my YouTube channel, which is 6 years old. I just haven't done anything on it, which I am really regretting at this point in time. But I had no confidence in myself or in my ability to get 5 subscribers, never mind the 83 that I have at this point in time. It's like to me, that's like a miracle. Where did the 83 people come from? And I want to thank the 80 people that's subscribed to my channel, because without knowing it, you are contributing, you are making a huge contribution towards helping me, helping myself, basically. Because subscribing is free. It doesn't really cost anybody anything. But obviously, then you must be interested in the person's channel or what's going on in the channel, or be prepared to listen to the person babbling on, because you need the watch hours as well. It's not only the subscribers, they must be able to just grind their teeth and endure whatever you are saying and just listen to it a little bit longer. Just pass the 30 second mark, people. Just pass the 30 second mark, please. 4,000 watch hours is a lot. Is a lot. And yes, I am going to end this video now, because this video was to be on that specific life event that took place 43, 44 years ago in my life. And so I don't want to taint it with too many other things, because a lot of people come to watch what you have to say on a specific topic, and then I wander off too much. So on these topics, I don't want to wander off too much. So I am going to say thank you for being with me on this. It was difficult for me to actually admit to what has happened, and maybe there was a lot of stuttering. I don't think I made a lot of eye contact, but it was just difficult to make. But now it's out, so in following videos I can refer back to this, and you will know what happened and what effects it might have had on the rest of my life since that event took place, because it did. It spiraled me into becoming sexually active at a far earlier age than what I actually would have wanted to. And also because of ignorance. I know they say ignorance is no excuse, but if you're that Ignorance sometimes is really an excuse. Really. If you don't know, you really don't know better. And yes, I want to thank you for watching through all these difficult memories and horrible things in my life that I actually share with you, opening my heart and my soul. And you must look after yourselves, and I hope that I will see you in a next video. Go well.